Welcome, everyone. Please rise and join in our gathering song.
Good morning.
I'm going to try to figure this out and see if I can croak my way through it, because I came down with a froggy nose and mouth last night. So I want to welcome you to Atonement for this first Sunday in Advent, and also all you folks out there that are joining us by your websites and whatever you use. So appreciate you could be here today. I want to welcome and introduce our guest pianist, Kristen Ryan. You probably know her, Chris Ryan, up on the prelude. And we have an acolyte this morning. His name is Gavin. And then we have a lector this morning. Her name is Kim Mangles. And I'm Sherman Olin, by the way, and I guess I'm the assistant today. So if I can be one. Let's see. And I guess I should introduce to you, and he's no need an introduction. I understand he was a minister at Atonement once years ago, and Reverend Karl Guhn is currently the leader of the pastors out at St. John's. And so he's probably training Darren. But if that's possible, I don't know. Well, anyways, welcome, and glad you could be here to preside this morning, Pastor Guhn.
I don't know if I'd call it training, Darren, but he's my replacement when I retire. So, July 11th is my final day there. Confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, who alone does wondrous things. Beloved, now is the time to wake from sleep. Let us confront our sins and confess them to the one who is merciful and just. God of new beginnings, we confess that we have not welcomed holy rain. We have strayed from your paths. We prepare for war instead of peace. We dishonor one another and your creation. Purify us with your refining fire and set us again on your way of love, that we may bear fruit worthy of repentance and welcome your coming among us. Amen. People of God, a new thing is growing in our midst, a tender branch, a living sign. By water and the Spirit, you are joined to this wonder. You have put on Christ, and your sins have been washed away. Rejoice in the way of the Lord. Let us pray. Stir up your power, Lord Christ, and come. By your merciful protection, save us from the threatening dangers of our sins. Enlighten our walk in the way of your salvation. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The Hebrew word ruach means spirit, breath, and wind. The interconnectedness of these images is clear throughout Scripture. In Genesis, the spirit wind of God blows over the waters at creation, and God breathes into the created human to give life spirit. Who we are created to be is centered in our breathing, which connects us to the one who created us. And now a reading from Genesis chapter 2. These are the generations of the heaven and the earth when they were created. In the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens, when no plant of the field was yet in the earth, and no herb of the field had yet sprung up, for the Lord God had not caused it to rain upon the earth, and there was no one to till the ground. But a stream would rise from the earth and water the whole face of the ground. Then the Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living being. And now an Advent prayer. O God, sweeping wind, life-giving breath, cleansing and guiding spirit, you are the source of all we are and all we can become. Your power roars and skips among the galaxies and flows delicately within our every cell, sustaining all life. You breathe mercy over us and teach us with truth and wisdom. Be with us and all of your people in this season and guide us so that we find comfort and confidence in your coming promise. In the name of the Holy One, who was, is, and is to come. Amen.
Morning. I'm kids want to come join me up here? Somewhere? Ah. Thank you, guys. Good morning. Did you guys have a good Thanksgiving? Yeah. So when we get ready for like Thanksgiving, like the holidays, is there anything, if you have Thanksgiving at your house, is there anything that you guys need to do to get ready? No? How about your moms? Is there anything your moms seem to be doing that look like they're maybe getting ready? No? Okay. Well, maybe you guys host differently. So usually if we have people coming over, like maybe if you have a friend coming over, do you clean your room or you just kind of leave it? I don't know if I want to know the answer. Maybe just shove it under the bed a little bit. Yeah, clean up. So yeah, there's things we do to prepare or get ready for company or maybe for your day. Have you ever woke up late and then been rushed? And yeah, that's not fun, is it? Your whole day you kind of feel like you're just not ready for the next thing because you just feel behind and rushed. Or maybe a test that you'd feel like you should have studied more for, or a performance or a game or a sporting event where you just felt like, oh man, I should have practiced more. So when those things happen, we feel unprepared and rushed, and it just feels kind of like, oh, yucky, you just don't feel ready. And this time of year, there's things that we do to prepare or get ready for Christmas. So what are some things you guys do to get ready for Christmas at home? Hang up ornaments, yeah, and decorate. So we do some of those things here. We have our tree and the Advent wreath and our nativity scene over there. So those are some things that we do. And sometimes people, you go shopping and you wrap presents and people do lots of baking. And those are things that we can do to prepare for the Christmas season. But here at church, we're preparing for Jesus' birth. So we do all these things in remembrance that this is, we're celebrating the birth of Jesus, the coming of Jesus. And today in our reading, we'll hear that Jesus will come again. And it talks about how no one knows when or what time or year or anything that Jesus will come, but Jesus will come again, and that we should be prepared. But it's kind of hard to think about how can we be prepared for something if we don't know when it's going to happen. Because usually, like, if you have a test, you're like, oh, I need to study for that because it's coming up next week. Or if you have something coming up, you know when to and how to get ready for it. But we don't know when Jesus is coming back. But God tells us we can prepare our hearts by living how he wants us to live. So to be good and kind and loving and to pray and to study the Bible and come to church and to live out his love with others and to love everybody. So we can do that so that when Jesus comes back, our hearts are ready and the world will be a little bit better place. Yeah, so those are ways that we can prepare. And this is an exciting season of Advent. So Advent is when we're preparing for Jesus and his birth. All right, you guys have been good. Thanks for coming up here. We'll say a prayer real quick. Dear God, thank you for coming to earth for us. Thank you for keeping your promises. Help us to live in your presence and to prepare our hearts for you. Thank you for your love. We love you, God. And thank you for Jesus. And in his name, amen.
This morning's scripture reading comes from Romans chapter 13. Besides this, you know what time it is, how it is now the moment for you to wake from sleep. For salvation is nearer to us now than when we became believers. The night is far gone, the day is near. Let us then lay aside the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us live honorably as in the day, not in reveling and drunkenness, not in debauchery and licentiousness, not in quarreling and jealousy. Instead, put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provisions for the flesh to gratify its desires. Here ends the reading. Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 24th chapter. Jesus said to the disciples, "About that day and hour no one knows, neither the angels of heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. For as the days of Noah were, so will be the coming of the Son of Man. For as in those days before the flood they were eating and drinking, marrying and given in marriage, until the day Noah entered the ark. And they knew nothing until the flood came and swept them all away. So too will be the coming of the Son of Man. Then two will be in the field, and one will be taken and one will be left. Two women will be grinding meal together, one will be taken and one will be left. Keep awake, therefore, for you do not know on what day your Lord is coming. But understand this. If the owner of the house had known in what part of the night the thief was coming, he would have stayed awake and would not have let his house be broken into. Therefore, you also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour." The Gospel reading. Well, as was mentioned, I am one of the chaplains at St. John's, the director of pastoral care there, and I bring you greetings from your partners in ministry there, St. John's United. And it's good to be with you. Kind of funny, it felt like I was the pastor here for a little while. Actually, all I was doing was helping David Peters out on Sundays. He told me it'd be 6 months. It ended up 18. So, and at the time I was the chaplain at Billings Clinic. Besides this, you know what time it is, how it is now the moment for you to wake from sleep. A couple of months ago, I asked Kristen if there was scheduled preachers through Advent, and she said, "No, not yet." And I said, "I want to do the four Sundays of Advent." It's been a while since I've been able to do that, but I wanted to do it because I love Advent. More than any other time in the church year, the hymns of Advent, the symbolism of the language, the readings in Advent, and their challenge to the world's way of life all fill me with hope. Hope that the world's way of exploitation and greed and violence will end. Hope that the kingdom will come. Another aspect of Advent that fills me up is that it's not easily commercialized. Coming between Thanksgiving and Christmas, it tends to get lost in the shuffle. And I think in part because there's only so much Amazon can do with a wreath and four candles. Moreover, the message that all things will be changed, reordered, transformed, and shaped by God in ways that neither we nor the world can control is not a message well received by the world, or even at times by us, if we're honest. All three lessons assigned for this day proclaim that the world is about to be transformed. Humanity itself will be transformed. And the promise is that God will act. There's nothing here about God consulting the faithful or even taking our desires into account. We cannot argue about free will or choice. God will act. And we're not given much choice. submit and join the kingdom, or be moved out of the way. That's the hard part of Advent. God is coming, and God will rule. We have made that a necessity. In our willful acts of destruction in the name of freedom or moral rightness, we have demonstrated that trustworthiness to constantly act with compassion on behalf of another is not who we are. The coming rule of God is equity, but we decry the loss of privilege over others. The coming rule of God is about peace and freedom, but we do not know how to live in freedom apart from violence. The coming rule is not to be feared, but we do tend to fear it. In the first lesson from Isaiah that we didn't use today, but I'll share a portion of, it shows a form of what the kingdom of peace shall involve. God shall judge between the nations, Isaiah writes, and shall arbitrate for many peoples. They shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nations shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. Our guns will be beat into instruments that feed all people. There's no arguing the point. It's God's work. We have a hard time with that because we see it as the diminishing of our self-determination and how it is we define freedom. However, if you look back over your life and reflect upon the moments where you felt you conquered or achieved and came out on top, they were never really lasting moments. My grandson at age 12 was on the Montana Little League team that went out to California to play. One of their games was televised on ESPN2. I looked at him and said, "It's all downhill from here." But reflect for a moment on those times when your heart melted, when you felt really good about who you were and the difference it made for others. Because those are the lasting moments. I recall my mom, as a part of the women's auxiliary of our church back in New Jersey, went to a nursing home to provide activities for the residents. She asked if I wanted to come along, and I think I was about 7, maybe 6. And I said, okay. And I spent the time helping. I chased down the balloon balls when they went wayward. I helped elders reach their drinks and snacks. I helped clean up. The residents, as we were getting ready to leave, either wheeled by or hobbled by and hugged me. They told me how special I was, but mostly how much fun the afternoon had been and how appreciative they were of our time. My heart soared. As I look back over my life, moments of service and care for others leave me feeling the freest and most valued as a human being. When I speak with veterans, I often hear the same kinds of emotions being uttered. The time of service, together with a band of brothers and sisters, a platoon caring for each other, accomplishing goals in community as a unit, are the most meaningful moments that they share. And they often relate that the hardest part of adjusting back to civilian life is finding that sort of brother and sisterhood or community again, dedicated service, working with others in unison for a meaningful outcome. This is the thing that's so hard for us to grasp at times. True freedom comes in service to others, in the care and nurturing towards a shared goal. This is what it means to be called into discipleship for the sake of God's kingdom. We are called to serve and care for our neighbors, for our enemies, or any person in need. We are called to heal the sick, feed the hungry, clothe the naked. When we do these things as an expression of our faith, we begin to understand both freedom and hope and peace in new ways. We do not live for self-determinism. We live, we're created for the sake of one another. The tension resides in the fact that the world's priorities are different. The world wants to draw us into conflict and competition. It wants to make winners and losers out of us. The winners find the best deals, live in the best houses, and drive the finest cars. The losers ask for help and are tender-hearted. The problem resides when we try and make the world's priorities somehow equated to God's kingdom. The symbols of this are everywhere and are even written, I think, into our language. You know, God and country is the phrase. God, guts, and guns tries to make each word equivalent to the other. I don't mean to upset you, but as Paul notes, it's time to wake up to the world's deceit. However, the goal is not to escape this material life, just to not get caught in the priorities of the world. Matthew lifts up an image that Jesus uses to explain what happens when we resist the kingdom in favor of the world. Now, the meaning of the image, I think, has been somewhat corrupted over time, particularly by works like Left Behind and the notion of the rapture. Remember those bumper stickers that read, "Warning, in case of rapture, this vehicle will be unmanned"? I always wanted one that said, "When the rapture occurs, can I have your stuff?" You see, the gospel is read to mean that those who vanish are the ones who are blessed, and those who are left behind are the faithless. But that is not what Jesus is saying if you read the gospel carefully. He uses the Noah flood imagery. The ones swept away are not the faithful. Those who are left are the ones who will be present to greet Jesus when he comes again. The ones who have been removed are the ones who have stood in the way of the kingdom. God is transforming all life, all the world, and the kingdom's priorities are made very clear for us. Advent is the season to wake up and remember what the kingdom priorities are. Advent calls us to repent from chasing the winner-loser competition cycle of the world. Wake up and remember. Rediscover how freedom lies in serving, and the heart of God's kingdom rests in the care for all people. God's kingdom is coming. Do we hear these words with hope or grieve what will be changed? Amen.
Let us profess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Prayers of the church this morning will be in a sense of what I call a call and response ending. And I will call by saying, Lord, in your mercy, and you will respond, receive our prayers. Here are our prayers of intercession for this Sunday. Before I start, I wanted to mention that a week ago or so, Nikki Groshand was explaining in her children's chat what prayer really is. And when she came to the conclusion that prayer is really talking to God, I thought, that's really what we're going to do. So let's talk to God. As we prepare for the fullness of Christ's presence, let us pray for a world that yearns for new hope. God of wonder, the earth's beauty and abundance is your gift. Teach us your ways of sharing resources and caring for life. God of peace, you judge the nations. We pray for lasting peace in the land of Jesus' birth. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of loving kindness, you desire fullness of life for everyone. Fill those who hunger, comfort the grieving, and attend to those near death. Help bring the hope to any who are sick or needing of your care. Kristen, Tia, John, Hilda, Bonnie, Laverna, and Diane. Lord, in your mercy, receive our prayer. God of community, you are present when we gather in your name. Guide congregations in transition or conflict. Give wisdom to congregational councils, call committees, and ministry leaders. Help us alert to unexpected opportunities for mission. Lord, in your mercy, receive our prayer. This week, we pray also for atonement members, Rex and Bonnie, Shelley, Lee, Isaiah, Krista, Emmy and Ella, Rudy and Becky. We lift up their prayers of need and thanksgiving, which are known to you. Lord, in your mercy, our prayer. This week, our prayers go on. Here's a prayer of God. I got to get started here. God of promise, your goodness is everlasting. We give thanks for the lives of the faithful who now rest in you. We trust that you will bring us into the company of all the saints with rejoicing. Lord, in your mercy, receive our prayer. God of our longing, you know our deepest needs. By your Spirit, gather our prayers and join them with the prayers of all your children. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you. Now, if you please would share the peace with one another, that would be the time for that.
I invite us to be seated. We have a special kind of celebration and recognition. And this is Ava Elizabeth Brownlee and Brock and Danny, her parents. And we welcome her. It was on November 26th that Ava's great-grandmother's birthday. She was the pillar of the family and encouraged the family to be part of a church community in their growing up years. Ava and her family have decided that Atonement is their church family. They found welcome and hospitality in a place where Ava and the family can grow in faith and community. So we celebrate and recognize publicly the baptism that occurred. And we're going to welcome her, and I think there's something, there we go, on the screens, together in unison. We welcome you into the body of Christ and into the mission we share. Join us in giving thanks and praise to God and bearing God's creative and redeeming word to all the world. Welcome. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah. We receive the offering.
See the
Let us pray. Eternal God, you make the desert bloom and send springs of water to thirsty ground. Receive these simple gifts of bread and wine and money, and make us messengers of your mercy and love for all in need of your healing and justice. We ask this through Christ our Savior. Amen. It was in the night in which he was betrayed that our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, given and shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering our Lord, we pray as he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now, I understand some of you commune individually where you're at, and at home, those who are watching. And if you do so, now is the time to commune. Be strong, do not fear. Here is your God who has come to save you. The body and blood of Christ given and shed for you. And then I invite the ushers to bring people forward.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Faithful God, in this meal you have remembered your mercy, bringing heaven to earth in the body and blood of Christ. As we wait for the day when all your promises will be fulfilled, sustain us and strengthen us by this holy mystery. Guide us toward your promised future, coming to birth in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God, the eternal Word, who dwells with us in Jesus and who holds us in the grace of the Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen. We sing our sending song.
I wanted to make and remind you all to be over at Little White Church on Wednesday evening at 6:30. It's going to be our midweek Lenten service, and it'll be in the form of a Holden's evening prayer. So please join us all over there. Thank you. Go in peace. Christ is near.
Thanks be to God.